Hello everyone, today I'm going to demonstrate how to set up Amazon S3 lifecycle management policies in order to make your buckets more efficient by cost optimization strategies. So as you can see here, this is a broad variety of storage classes we offer within Amazon S3. Today I will not be talking too much in detail about each of the storage classes, but keep in mind each of the storage classes is catered to serve a use case depending on the access pattern of the workload. Just to provide some context here, the third storage class from the left, a general rule of thumb here is Amazon S3 Standard is a great storage class for objects accessed more than once per month. Then we have Amazon S3 Standard Infrequently Accessed, which is good for objects accessed around once per month. Then we have Amazon S3 Glacier Instant Retrieval, which is good for objects accessed once per quarter. Then we have Amazon S3 Glacier Flexible Retrieval, which is good for objects accessed once every 6 months. And then in the end, we have Amazon S3 Glacier Deep Archive, which is good for objects accessed once every year. Now, if you have a workload where the object access patterns change in a predicted way, you can use lifecycle management policies to make it more efficient. Let's take a look at an example. In this example, we have a workload where the objects being accessed are several times a month until the first 3 months, and then it is not as much around, and then after 90 days we only see access around once per quarter, and then after 365 days we only need it for retention purposes. With this, rule number 1 will move all of the objects older than 90 days to S3 Glacier Instant Retrieval. Keep in mind here that S3 Glacier Instant Retrieval is a synchronous storage class, and in this case we will have our objects, once they are created and uploaded, we will have the objects in Amazon S3 Standard for the first 90 days, and then we will have it tiered down to Amazon S3 Glacier Instant Retrieval for cost optimization. Then, as you saw previously in the example, we wanted to have a storage class where we need to have our objects just for retention purposes. With this, we have a rule number 2 set up, where rule number 2 will move objects older than 365 days to S3 Glacier Deep Archive. This is how you can cost optimize your buckets by moving objects from one storage class to another once you know the access patterns of the objects in your bucket. So this is how you can use Amazon S3 Lifecycle to optimize your storage spend. You can do two things. You can either transition objects, which means you can transition objects from one storage class to another, or you can either expire objects, where you can use lifecycle management policies to mark those objects for expiration, and then Amazon S3 deletes expired objects on your behalf. The chart on the right shows storage class transitions that are allowed, and as you can see, it follows a waterfall method, which means you can only go down the chart, but you cannot do the other way around. For example, you can transition from Amazon S3 Standard to any other storage class, but you cannot do that from Amazon S3 Standard Infrequently Accessed to, you cannot come back from Amazon Standard Infrequently Accessed to Amazon S3 Standard. You can use lifecycle to expire objects after some defined time. With that, let's go on our AWS console. So here, as you can see, we are in my AWS environment. Let's go and select S3. To use lifecycle management policies on a certain bucket, we have to go and select that bucket first, and then go on and select management, and then you'll see lifecycle rules. We'll go and say create lifecycle rule. As you see here, the first thing it prompts us is to name our lifecycle rule. So let's say LC1. You can do two things with this lifecycle management policies. You can make it act on all of the objects in your bucket, or you can limit the scope of the rule using one or more filters. Let's say you only wanted this lifecycle management policy to act on a certain prefix in your bucket. You can input that prefix here. If you have a bucket with multiple prefixes and you only want that lifecycle management policy to act on objects with certain tags, then you can use the key and the value pair given here. And then this lifecycle management policy will only act on the objects with a certain tags. You can also filter it down by object size. Let's say you want this lifecycle management policies to act on objects more than 1 MB in size, then you can specify the minimum object size here In this case, we specify 1 MB, so 1 megabyte. So in this case, this rule will only act on objects which are more than 1 MB in size. For this example, we'll just apply it to all objects in the bucket. And as you see here, there's 5 things you can do with lifecycle rule actions. The first one is to move current versions of the objects between storage classes. So as you saw previously in the example what I mentioned, you can use this to move the current versions of the objects between storage classes. So in this case, let's say we will move it to S3 Glacier Instant Retrieval after 90 days of object creation. So day 1 to day 90, when the object is created, after 90 days, it's going to move it to S3 Glacier Instant Retrieval. And then after 365 days, we only need it for retention purposes. Then we'll use S3 Glacier Deep Archive and say 365 days. And with this, it's going to move the objects to S3 Glacier Deep Archive from S3 Glacier Instant Retrieval after 365 days. Also, you need to keep in mind when you transition small objects to S3 Glacier Flexible Retrieval or S3 Glacier Deep Archive, you are charged a fixed amount of storage to accommodate metadata for managing the object, which increases storage costs. So let's say I acknowledge. And as you see here, it stays from 0 to 90 in S3 standard. Then after 90, it moves it to S3 Glacier Instant Retrieval. And then after 365 days, it moves the object to S3 Glacier Deep Archive. Now, the other way to move or delete current versions of the objects is by selecting expire current version of the objects. This is the same as what we saw before. The only difference is with the first rule, we were transitioning objects from a storage class to another. With this rule setup, we are expiring objects. So let's say we want to expire objects after 365 days of creation. With this rule setup, the object will live in Amazon S3 standard for 365 days. And once 365 days passes, it's going to expire and mark that object for deletion. Now the next thing is moving non-current versions of the objects between storage classes. So when you select that, you can move a non-current version between the storage classes just as you saw previously, where we were moving current version of the storage classes. What is the difference is with non-current versions, if you have a version enabled bucket, you can optimize it more further by keeping the current version in the most optimized storage class and then moving all the non-current versions to a cheaper storage class. So in this case, let's say we want to move all of the non-current versions which have been passed 30 days to S3 standard infrequently accessed, and then we'll move it to S3 Glacier Instant Retrieval after 180 days. And then this is one of the things you can also mention. So let's say we want to also have one of the objects from a non-current versions to always sit with our current version, right? So in this case, as you see here, nothing happens to the current version. Day 30, one newest non-current versions is retained, which means our current version and the one of the non-current versions will stay in Amazon S3 standard, and then all other non-current versions move to S3 standard infrequently accessed, which is shown in rule number 1. After day 180, again, one of the newest non-current versions is retained, and then all of the other non-current versions move to S3 Glacier Instant Retrieval after 180 days. So now this is how you can move non-current versions between storage classes. The next rule I'm going to talk about is permanently delete non-current versions of the objects. This is very similar to what we spoke before. The only difference is rather than transitioning between storage classes, we are marking it for deletion. So here in this case, let's say after 30 days when the object becomes non-current and I only want to keep one copy, with this it means nothing will change to the current version, but when a non-current version, we will keep one newest non-current version with our current version, and then all of the other non-current versions will be permanently deleted after 30 days, right? So this is how you can cost optimize by moving non-current versions or deleting non-current versions of objects. The last piece here is talking about deleting expired object delete markers or incomplete multipart uploads. So as you know, with a version bucket, when you delete a certain object, Amazon S3 places a delete marker on top of it, which means that the delete marker becomes the current version of the object. In this case, you also want to clean up these delete markers, and you can do that by using this rule here. And the last piece is using incomplete multipart uploads. So when you upload larger objects to Amazon S3 via the multipart API, sometimes when the upload is not successfully uploaded, then in that case, all of those uploads which have been there previously are incomplete, right? And they incur storage costs. So in this case, you want to delete incomplete multipart uploads. And in this case, you can say after 7 days. So if there's any incomplete multipart uploads 7 days after that object is created, you can delete that, which will help you incur less storage costs. With that being said, this is an overview of S3 lifecycle management policies in our AWS console. You can scan the QR code from your smartphones or visit this website for more details. Thank you for your time.